Joining us right now is the man, Tilman Fertitta. He's the chairman and CEO of Landry's and many other companies. It's a pleasure to have you on the show.
Hey, great to be here.
So tell us about your business. What do you do? You own many, many businesses, but I'll let you tell us all about them.
It's great to be in business, and it really is. Lots of concepts. Do over 150 million customers a year, and it's brands from probably, we touch everybody, because we hit all the price
points. Many I've been to.
but anything from Mastro's to Bubba Gump. And then in between is a Martin's and a McCormick and a Rainforest and a Saltgrass and a Chart House and
everything.
And everything. And they're all company owned. They're all owned by my company. There's no franchisees. There's no licensees except international. And then the five Golden Nugget casinos also. And then lots of brands from the aquarium to amusement parks. And it's a fun business. Lots of employees. Business is good. And it's fun.
So I'll say the numbers for you because they were on the sheet. $3.4 billion in sales, $3.5 billion worth of assets, and over 60,000 employees. How the heck do you make all of that happen when some people have been in business as long as you and they're still doing the same thing they always did and they're still getting the same results? There's something that you're doing that's different. You've got a TV show where you actually help people do this. How do you get to that level? What does it take?
It just kind of happened over a period of time, believe it or not. You know, it was great to go public back in 1993. I had 12 restaurants. And God, you know, I was sitting on top of the world. You're sitting there with 12 restaurants. You're making $3 million a year. And gosh, life is good. And then all of a sudden going public with a restaurant company was real popular at the time. So I was public for 18 years. You wake up, you know, in August of 93 and you own 12 restaurants and all of a sudden you look at your stock and you're worth $100 million. So that's the catalyst. And then, you know, I was able to grow it to a billion-dollar company as a public company, almost $2 billion. Wow. And then when you had the recession in 08 and 09 and all the stocks fell, I took the opportunity to buy it all back myself. Private equity wanted to do it with me, and I maneuvered, financially engineered it where I could take my whole company back private. And that's when I was really able to grow, because coming out of a recession, a lot of stocks were down, Martin's, McCormick & Schmick, Bubba Gump, that I was able to do a lot of acquisitions. So
that's what I love, and I want to point out right there. People like yourself have the mindset that in a down economy and in a recession, that's where there's more opportunity than ever before, and you capitalized on that.
100%. I mean, I'm a cyclical player, okay? You always want to have your cash ready and wait for the recession, because that's when you're able to buy. Everybody looks smart when you have a booming market, okay, regardless if you're public or private. When you can be smart is when it's a down market and say, hey, I can pick this off or I can pick this off. And that's what me and my team have been really good at, if you want to know the truth. We've had lots of concepts that had organic growth, but if you really look at the value of the company, it was probably created by being a cyclical player and buying companies when they were down. But we also had the ability to take those companies and fix them up. You know, you go into a Martin Steakhouse today, it's a different menu, it's a different look. You look at a Chart House, great locations, but reconcepted the logo to the look to the menu, everything. Keep it fresh and change.
I love that. Change is inevitable, and you learn how to capitalize on that. I've come up with something that I like to do on the show where if you imagine sitting at a table with, and you maybe even have, an Oprah Winfrey, Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, Tony Robbins, somebody like yourself, which is why this is perfect, and you could take all of their biggest lessons and aha moments from their successes and their failures, I think those lessons would be pretty valuable. So from your perspective, what has been one or two of the biggest aha moments or lessons in a time of failure or success on your journey so far?
Being an opportunist, okay? Don't assume anything and be a cyclical player. And if you take those and the biggest mistake that people make is that when things are really good, they think that they're never gonna be bad again. And when things are really bad, they think they're never going to be really good again. So always know when things are good, the bad's coming. And when things are bad, always know the good is coming.
It's an interesting mindset. I love that, though, because it helps for so many of the beginning entrepreneurs out there that don't think like that. I think it's great advice. So let's talk about that. Three things, or more if you want, three things that you feel like the beginning entrepreneur in year one, two, and three that they haven't yet learned because they haven't been in the game as long as you. What are the things they need to know and be prepared for in the future?
Well, one of the things I do with all, and doing this television show really gives me the opportunity to mentor people besides buy product. Yeah. Sell, buy their product that gives them a, an opportunity to really get their company going. Is you got to know your numbers. And a lot of people go into partners with somebody, whether it's their best friend or whoever. Yeah. But if you know numbers well and you're a financial person, then you better get a partner who knows how to sell and market or knows how to operate whatever you're doing. But a lot of times people go into business together and they both have the same talent.
Because you hire people like you.
Yeah, but you really, for a business to get going, you've got to have, number one, a great product. Yeah. You got to understand the financial side, okay? And then you've got to be able to operate that business, and then you need to have to sell and market that business. And if you don't do all four of those things in the beginning, you're not going to be successful.
Very true. I want to know, and I'm so curious from somebody like yourself, did you have great mentors growing up, or did you have to figure it out all on your own?
You know, I really, people have always asked me, who were your mentors? And I really did not have mentors in the beginning. Now, as you get older and smarter, do we all steal little ideas from everybody? Absolutely. Yeah. And I don't care what business you're in. Yeah. But you as you grow, you're definitely smarter. And I will tell you this. I have lots of young guys work for me, and I love the millennials, and I love the way they're creative. But there is nothing like history, okay? And it's no different as you go get somebody to come in and run my company today with 500 locations and 60,000. I don't care who you are. There's nothing like the history, because I know the history of all 500 of those locations.
Yeah.
Somebody else doesn't. So there's nothing like history, but if you don't change, you will get run over.
Yeah.
And I'd say, how did your company continue to grow and last as long as it has and been successful? Because I preach change, change, change.
I love that. So let's talk about failure then. What's been one of the big failures or seasons of adversity that you or your business has gone through where, and maybe you're a superhero and you haven't ever thought this, but I think I need to give up. I think it's not going to work. I either maybe not need to go get a job in your case, but maybe I need to shut this business down or this one of our assets or fire these people. Tell me about a season of adversity or a time where you failed.
You know, I've never had that major failure. You know, do you have locations that go bad, or should you have done this acquisition and you negotiated it too hard that you negotiated yourself out of it? I've never had that just huge failure.
Okay.
And if you sit there and you see it coming, a lot of times you're able to prevent it. And, you know, a chain that I started, Joe's Crab Shack, where it grew to like 200 units, I could see that from the early 90s and is in the late 90s and early 2000 that we were going from a bait camp, look for a restaurant, to more lifestyle centers and more sophisticated restaurants. Mm-hmm. And I saw that and I said, you know what? It's getting harder to find a location because people don't want a Joe's Crab Shack and this type of a location. And so I sold it, and I sold it for a good price, and it was the right thing to do. And so a lot of times it's always looking into the future, not what you just have today, but always look into the future and try to see what's happening so you can make the right decision. And if you look into the future and make the right decisions, you'll never have that large failure. You'll just continue to have little ones along the way.
Break it down for us. Recap what your company does, or all your companies.
Well, I have one of the largest top 10 gaming companies in America, one of the largest restaurant companies in America, and do a lot of other things. One of the largest operators of aquariums in America, in the top 10 and all
the largest
of
everything in America.
You know, not the largest, but, you know, one of the largest in all of those aspects. It's all in the entertainment. It's all taking care of the customer, and that's what I knew how to do. So when I started out, I stayed in that realm. You know, everybody said, "Well, how do you understand the gaming business?" Well, the gaming business was the easy part. If you talk to people in gaming, it's how do you operate that hotel and operate all the F&B and all those restaurants inside those properties. Yeah. Gaming's easy. It's everything else that makes the business difficult.
You're all about the people, and that's one of the things that you attribute to your success. Not only the people being the customers, but also the people in the team. You have over 60,000 people on your team of employees. How do you incentivize them? How do you find them and hire them and retain them? Especially the millennials nowadays, that's one of the biggest issues with most companies.
Well, they are harder to retain because they love to come in and put Landry's on their resume and then go somewhere else.
And then jump.
They're always looking for the next deal. But what's amazing is I probably have 25 VPs that have averaged over 20 years with me.
Wow.
And so how are you able to do that? Number one, I would say we're the bull, okay? And when times are tough, they're never worried about something happening to us. It's always been, that's feasting time for Landry's. We're going to go out and we're going to eat the week.
Yeah, they know their king is leading the castle.
No, it really is. I mean, I hate to say it, but they're also part of that castle and they're part of that team. But they know that a recession, well, I'm not worried about me losing my job. I'm not worried about anything happening to Landry's. I know that we're going to be growing. And that's a culture, is knowing that you're the bull in the room. And I think that's why my retention of my senior people has been so good for so long. But you also got to remember, they all started out young.
Yeah.
They've all had the opportunity to make a lot of money.
Okay.
And we were a very young company at one point, and now we're not so young anymore.
60,000 people. What are some of the DNA or things that you're looking for when, I don't care if it's a C-level executive, a VP, or just somebody who's coming in to be a low-level employee on the totem pole to work their way up, what are the things you look for in your people?
You know, we're not a lifestyle company, okay? Landry's is a get-after-it company. And if you're looking for a lifestyle company, that's not us, okay?
Yeah.
You can come to my office and you can be there at 7 o'clock on a Thursday or Friday night, and you'll still see a lot of people there, okay? Mm-hmm. So in a way, maybe it is a lifestyle because people love their jobs so much that that work there. They don't care if they're finished at 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock. I'm talking about the senior people, you know, that they want to accomplish what they want to accomplish. So that's always fascinated me, is that how many people work late at my company, knowing that they don't have to. So that tells me there's something happening here, that people like being in this office. Mm. But it's all about the people. It's totally about the people, the culture, all the way down. And that's one of the things that I feel like I've been fortunate to do, is develop a culture in our company that goes down all the way to the restaurants, because I don't get to go to everything anymore. So if I wasn't able to do that and there be a culture, we still wouldn't be successful today.
So those are things for the people. And on the note of people, you know, whether it's the profit or even on your show, I think you talk about this as well. Maybe you say it in different words, but the three things that you look for in a business are the people, the product, and the process. So we'll talk about each of those. We just talked about people. Some people think that some are more important than the other. Out of those three, is there one that's more important to you, people, product, or process?
I think you got to have all of them, okay? Mm-hmm. People, of course, you got to have the right people, and you got to have people that want to be leaders and people that want to be the best. Process, one of the reasons that we're successful is we know our numbers, and we know that the linen cost should be 3/10 or this cost should be 4/10. And if you're not running those costs, then you have a people problem. And I've never not acquired anybody that I wasn't able to go in and fix their numbers by 3 or 4% by just running your business better. And I think that's something that we do extremely well, is analyze everything. And you'd be shocked at the restaurant companies that don't have analysts. And we do weekly inventories. We always want to know where we are. You can't fix a problem a month later. You got to fix it next week.
I love that, because successful people, all the successful people I know, from billionaires to millionaires, the one thing that's in common with them is they all know their numbers. Systems is something that I want to touch on with you, we agreed on. A lot of people don't start with the end in mind and put the systems in place. One of my friends and mentors, Max Carey, built Outback Steakhouse from one restaurant to over 2,000. And he said, we started with the end in mind. We knew that 2,000 was one of our goals. And we put the systems in place from the first restaurant, from the hiring, the training, and everything to get there. What's your advice for the businesses that don't have the systems in place right now?
Put them in place before you grow.
Put them in place
because that's where so many people screw up. They don't have the systems in place. So many small companies, operations and growing gets ahead of their financial side, and they don't know where they are, and they don't even know if they're making money or not. So the one thing that I would tell anybody who's starting, especially to grow outside of one location, is know where you are financially and make sure that part of your business, that you're getting current numbers immediately before you start trying to expand. Mm-hmm. When I can tell you exactly when it happened, around 1988, 89, that, because I was a typical business, your numbers would come in months later because accounting just doesn't keep up with your business. Mm-hmm. But as soon as I started getting current numbers, where by the end of the month, I had numbers on the 10th of the month, okay, my businesses when it started growing. Okay, because so I could see where I was and fix the mistakes.
Okay, so the faster you can get the metrics and the numbers in place,
and
the faster
you
can
systems,
make tweaks and changes.
All your analytical numbers to totally know your business. They're all businesses are basically the same. Yeah. This is a cost of sales. This is a labor cost. This is this cost. Know your numbers. If you know your numbers, you know where your issues are and you can fix them.
Well, numbers relate back to sales and marketing as well, as we touched on. So I'm curious for you, is there a specific type of marketing that's worked best for your businesses? Do you use direct mail? Do you use social media now as your businesses have grown over the decades? Does one work better than the other?
Your best marketing for us today is digital. It's just amazing how the world has changed.
So you've evolved into that then?
100%. Okay. 100%. But we probably, you know, over the years, you did TV, you did billboards, but digital is where it's at today. I mean, it's a known fact that if, and because you can go after exactly who you want to go after with digital, and that's why it's so much better.
Yeah.
When you're driving down the street and somebody's looking at a billboard or you're running a television ad, even though you can do different demographics for different audiences, for digital, you can just flat out go after this
the exact person
who you know is going to pay attention to it. And that's what makes digital so smart today. And every year there's more millennials and we're just able to zone in on them. So it's today, that is 100% where it's at. You can take a big company today, and I can tell you billboards and television is a waste.
I agree 100%. So. Because I'm in the online marketing space, and I know how specific you can get with your targeting. And at the end of the day, that's what it boils down
to. That's all it is.
Because customer acquisition and lifetime value are going to boil down to your marketing dollars and who you're targeting. My question for you is, six most deadly words in business are, we've always done it this way. So at some point, how did you break away from the old model of marketing and say, this whole digital thing is something we need to focus on?
Well, it goes back to my change. And you know, I just buying a company in New York right now. Okay. And in the last week, we've heard, we've always done it this way. And my answer to that is, and all my people tell them is, well, that's why we bought you, because you've always done it that way. And that's why you're not buying us. Yeah. Because it's change. Don't, you want to lose me? Tell me that's the way we've always done it, okay?
Yeah.
Don't ever tell me that. That is the biggest failure of business, is we've always done it that way. What's the number one reason a business fails? We've always done it that way, and time will pass you by.
That's why I said it's six most deadly words in business. How does a normal day look like for somebody like you? You know, for me, a big shift in my perspective was I should only focus on the highest income and impact activities and find some way to, you know, outsource and delegate the low income, low impact, trivial activities. You have 60,000 employees, so you're the master of this. How do you decide where to allocate your time and energy?
Yeah, it's everywhere. And I'll be, some people can multitask and some can't. And it's not something you develop. You were just born with it. But the other day, my general counsel was in my office and we were going over something. And he said, do you realize you just handled six totally different divisions of the company in about a 2-minute period? You were picking up the phone, yelling out to this person, bringing this person in while they were just sitting there. And that's, it's you try to put your arms around everything, but you have to delegate, okay? You can't be running a company like this and not delegate. But at the same time, you do get involved in the most minuscule details. I mean, I did a tasting yesterday for a new restaurant and went through every dish with them and gave them my input. I'll still look at menu changes. I'll look and see what we're paying to, in a position for this person. It's just, you just touch whatever you feel like you need to touch at that time. And your people learn that this is how far I can go in my area. And if not, maybe I need to go check with him. So I operate with seven COOs, and they all answer up to me.
Interesting.
So that's the way I operate.
I love that. Well, last question as we wrap up, I'm super curious to see your perspective on this, is if you have so many different businesses, so if you had to start over with nothing except for the knowledge that you have, no connections, no money, you had to start over with nothing but the knowledge you have, what business space would you get into right now? What industry? You're like, I own 87 different businesses already.
I do, and I truly don't know, okay? I don't know, because I know that I could probably even do some other things better than what I'm doing, but I love my empire that I have.
Yeah.
But I can tell you this, the one true statement that is said out there, there's a lot of entrepreneurs that have gotten lucky because they happened to go to work for a company at the right time and they really weren't the brain behind it, but made a bunch of money. if you take your true 500 entrepreneurs out there who truly built it with their own hands and building their company, and it was a business that wasn't losing $10 million a year, but yet their stock was worth $1 billion, okay? Yeah. If you take those 500 people, they'll have all the money again, okay? You either have it or you don't. It's you're born with it, okay?
I've heard
and
that
people
before.
People say, well, what about if I go get my MBA? And my deal is, you know what? You know if you need your MBA, all right? If you don't have that God-given gift, go get your MBA.
Go get it.
Okay, because then you really do learn a lot in getting your MBA. But a lot of people doesn't mean anything.
Wise words from a true business rock star. Thanks for coming on the show.
Absolutely. Glad to be here, Mark.